think we have some good journalists in the audience based on these questions, and also clearly some doctors, because some of them, I think I'll be able to read them. Ellen, we had a few for you specifically, so I'll start there and pick on you. This one is, many counties closed their enrollment at certain levels. Do you see Washtenaw Health Plan Plan B having to go this way in the future?
At this point, we have not closed our doors, and we're working very hard not to close our doors. As I mentioned, our enrollment has grown last year by 40%, and revenues for the program are declining. So at some point, the choices that we'll have to make are close enrollment, cut benefits, make other administrative kinds of changes. But so far, we're still available.
Second one for you. Why is the small business program attracting so few businesses?
I defer to Catherine's wisdom on that, in the sense that small businesses are dropping their health coverage. The Small Business Health Plan is targeting businesses with low-wage workers, mom-and-pop shops who are really operating on the margin, who haven't provided health insurance for their employees because they haven't been able to afford it. And even though we think that the premium level at $200 and some a month, it's certainly less than some of these other programs, it's still prohibitively expensive for small businesses in our community.
This is one more for you, and then we'll leave you alone.
Thank you.
is physician participation voluntary in WHB? I actually don't know the answer to that either.
Is it voluntary? No in the sense. yes and no. Physicians are, in fact, paid for the services that they provide to members in the program. They're not paid very much. So for all intents and purposes, it's somewhere between a charity and a government program. Here at the University of Michigan, where the Executive Vice President for Medical Affairs has set the vision that the university will treat members of our community, it is it's an expectation that members, WHP members, will be seen. So.
Well done. This gets at your funding just a little bit. How are you keeping it solvent with the state of the economy here in Michigan, and will there be a need for greater funding from the private sector in the future?
Yes. as I said, increased demand for enrollment, shrinking revenues. The funding for the program is not stable in these uncertain times, and we are certainly, as an organization, looking for alternative ways to fund the program.
Okay.
Are you done picking on me?
I am. I was going to move on to Catherine now. Dr. McLaughlin, do the Clinton-Obama-McCain plans offer any solutions to cover illegal immigrants?
No. If you go up their websites, they really avoid that term, and for good reasons, right? I think that any politician in a campaign, particularly trying to get different voting groups, can't do that. Now, some individual states have done it. The state of California, not surprisingly, has talked about it, and Governor Schwarzenegger in his plan last year, which was modeled after the Massachusetts plan, was very much about what they call, they don't call them illegal immigrants in California, they call them non-citizen residents, I think is the current term. And they have to deal with this population, particularly in Southern California, because it constitutes a very large percent of the people that the doctors are seeing and then the hospitals are seeing. So he, in fact, included it. But at the presidential level, they're avoiding putting anything in writing about that right now.
Okay. Also one for you. Why not discuss universal care provided by a single payer, namely the federal government?
no one is doing it this time. I mean, the only one who did was Dennis Kucinich, and, you know, he dropped out of the race quite a long time ago. Mm-hmm. I think part of it is that they have discovered it's not politically viable, and, you know, you may have a different view on that, Kevin, but again, when I was part of that federal commission, that was another one that I didn't bring up, that when we went and we had a hearing in Boston, and, you know, the state of Massachusetts was facing their reform, and we had a whole contingent of people there testifying that if we went to universal coverage, we would reduce costs by 30%, you know. So we got up to 120% in four of our hearings, which was really amusing. Kevin is right. The current system does have a lot of inefficiencies in it, a lot of administrative costs that are frustrating and don't lead to benefits to the individual. But unfortunately, it's very, very difficult to get a really good measure of how much cost would be reduced. It's one of those things that we know costs would go down, but it certainly would not go down by 30%. The research that led to that is not very good empirical research. It's sort of seat of the pants kind of comparison of Canada to the United States. And if you look historically over time, cross-country comparisons in a much more technically more sophisticated analysis, it's much less than 30%, but certainly positive. But I think that universal coverage, you know, 4 years ago and 12 years ago and 20 years ago gets equated to socialized medicine, which it is not. But because those factions are out there, politicians are concerned about using that term because they're worried they're going to be branded as socialists and not wearing flag pins in their lapels, and gosh, what's next?
Here's a fun one. Did the Michael Moore movie Sicko help or hurt raising general social awareness about health insurance issues and the uninsured?
That's a great question. I don't have any empirical evidence of whether it helped or hurt. I think the School of Public Health here had a private showing beforehand, and there were several faculty members who then were interviewed about it, and I think the consensus was that he overplayed his hand and he made the insurance the bad guys. And the fact is, the insurance aren't the bad guys, and doctors aren't the bad guys, and small business owners aren't the bad guys. That one of the things I liked about Kevin, we're all in this together, and we all have to bear some responsibility. And so to that extent, some analysts were frustrated by the movie because it took cheap shots. At the other hand, it you know, got Oprah Winfrey to devote an entire show to it and say, gosh, I thought because I'm wealthy and I have good health insurance, I was just swell. And I could get everything I wanted, and I would be just swell. And seeing the movie made me realize that I'm also vulnerable, that things don't work out quite as well as they should, and that we need some kind of reform. So I think that aspect was good.
Great. Thank you. Kevin, we're going to pick on you now. You can read this. Let us assume a liberal is elected president. Looking at the cost issues, who would you work on first to, rethink their expectations? If anybody wants to chime in.
Okay. I think I get it. First, let me comment on Michael Moore. I thought it was a terrific movie. Because movies, to me, succeed if they, particularly sort of documentaries with opinion, if they get people talking. And what he, I think, did a great job in that is he basically said, we have a system that is really set up so that everyone makes money. And the system delivers exactly as designed. And then, you know, cheap shots are a way, to me, of raising awareness and creating dialogue. And you don't always agree with all of them, but I think the movie succeeds because it got everyone talking. Now, if a liberal is elected, which would be pretty cool, I think you need to understand that our system is really not a system where one person will effectively have their way. Our government is a government of interest groups. And you get things done by having a bunch of interest groups actually give up their self-interest for the public interest. So I think what the liberal does is it becomes the card in terms of veto, in terms of effectively having a little bit more influence in the debate. And I totally agree with Catherine that I think it's because of the strength of different interest groups, it would be very hard to get to a single payer. But I think logically, the liberal candidate would be looking for some consolidation in insurance, probably would be looking to encourage nonprofit medicine and probably nonprofit insurance, and would be very much on the drug company agenda. And I think having a president where everyone knows that they're going to have a priority for some of these pieces, I think that would be a good thing. And you put that together with really a very strong advocate for a universal coverage system.
Okay, thank you. This is an interesting question. What methods, and this is for any of you, I think, what methods of messaging have been used to so successfully assure that those of us who are uninsured or underinsured feel it is our private shame, that it's somehow a failure?
Well, since I've got the, then I'm going to pass it down to you, Ellen. I think one of our problems in terms of social policy since the early 60s, and I don't think it's messaging, but what we tend to do when we have a disadvantaged population is we create a categorical program that puts people within a special funding niche and identifies them as different from everyone else. So we've determined, quite honestly, for Medicaid, that there are certain categories of people that are deserving of Medicaid, and other people are simply not. And so I think that there's something very much embedded in our culture to creating categorical approaches to broad problems that really begins to stigmatize people. And a lot of it has to do with the problems of getting a broad consensus on more societal-based issues.
I wanted to comment on it, too, because I think it actually goes back to something Catherine talked about earlier, which is the myths about who are the uninsured. So there is a lot of rhetoric out there that says the uninsured are uninsured by choice. And you saw the data that Catherine shared with you that is a more accurate picture. Some of that rhetoric comes from those who don't want to take on the hard issue of reform and who want to really maintain the status quo. And I think that is a very much prevalent in our communications and in the strategies. You'll remember in many of you, maybe not all of you, in 93 and 94 when the last major effort for healthcare reform occurred in the Clinton administration, that there was an ad featuring Harry and Louise that was very much a fear-mongering ad about what change would result in. And nobody on the panel yet today has talked about how change gets stopped in the process. That was a very effective ad, ran only in Washington, D.C., spread around the country in terms of creating fear in people about what they would lose with healthcare reform. And I think it's the same interest groups who really try and maintain the status quo who spread a lot of the myths that Catherine talked about earlier.
I wanted to say that the fear in that case with the Harry and Louise was choice. That all of the socialized medicine, the government, we heard this all the time in these hearings. Whenever we talked about universal health care, people immediately went, well, you're talking about socialized medicine. We'd say, no, we're not talking about socialized medicine. Well, you're taking away my choice. And look how government runs everything else. I don't want government deciding what medical care I get or giving me my medical care. So they immediately think that this means every physician is going to be a government employee. Every hospital is going to be owned by the government. And so there is a lot of ignorance out there that the messaging that's been used by the people who stand to lose from change has been very effective. And a lot of the stuff, as I said, in 1994 with the Harry and Louise was about choice. And if you read John McCain's, go to his website, he uses the word choice, like 50 times. And I want choice, and I want you to have choice, and we're going to have choice. So we're going to let the market do it. We're not going to have government do it. We're going to have choice. And so we already know what the dialogue's going to be. We already know what they're going to pin this on. The other thing I want to say in terms of lobbying groups, so everybody talks about lobbying groups, and SICO talked about lobbying groups, but the fact of the matter is, and Uwe Reinhardt, one of the most liberal health economists in the country, and who was on Oprah with Michael Moore, makes the point all the time. When we say that 15% of the budget is healthcare, or there's $3 trillion going to healthcare, that's $3 trillion of revenue. And you've got to think about it. That's $3 trillion going in your pocket, because you're a physician, going in your pocket, your insurance, going in your pocket, you're the hospital. It's $3 trillion of revenues of citizens of the United States who are providing that health care and those services. And so if you think about cutting costs and cost containment, you're talking about cutting people's income. And that's politics.
Also, for anyone who wants to dive in here, how did our current healthcare model come to be based on privilege of employment status and privilege of relationship status? That's a big one.
Well, we could all do that because we've all done lectures on that, and it goes back to the 1940s and the wage and price controls during World War II, and we'll all talk with you privately about it. But it is there are other countries that do relate their health coverage to employment status as well, but they do it in a social system and they do it through universal coverage. Our country created it. It's an artifact of a system that was designed to respond to labor shortages during World War II, and it's become embedded. And it's in one of the things I think Kevin was trying to get at was whether we have to break that tie between employment and coverage in order to get true universal coverage. And many people have discussed that issue in this country. Very hard tie to make. Probably not going to happen in the short term.
Okay, I'm going to try to squeeze in three last questions, and if we keep it brief, we're running out of time here, but if everybody can stay just a few minutes over, there's a couple of, and unfortunately we couldn't get to all of them, but you guys are all around and accessible. And who can give a description of the best medical delivery national system in the world? What country is that? Does it exist?
I got a pick.
Several that are held up as successful, but if you talk to people who live in those countries, they complain about their system too. But I mean, people point to Japan, to Germany, to, you know, the Netherlands. I mean, there's several, Sweden, there's several examples that appear to be working fairly well. But the dirty little secret is their rate of cost growth is identical to ours. So even though the level of cost is lower than ours, the growth rate in the last 20 years is the same. And they have single payer, they have, you know, they don't do fee-for-service, so with all due respect, Kevin, they do all the things that you talked about to reduce costs. That's what they do. And the thing that we all have in common across all these countries is technological change. And most economists will tell you that's the cost driver, is technology.
And who's your pick? My pick was New Zealand, believe it or not.
Oh, yes. That's a good one, too.
New Zealand, actually, because we were there last year, and it was the first country I'd been in where everyone we talked to really thought they were doing a good job. And they were very introspective and wanted to continuously improve. But it's very much along the models, though, that Catherine's talking about.
Just quickly, even though they have the same rate of growth, and it is technological, and to some degree in the European countries, aging as well, they do start from a lower base than we do, and every single country except ours does limit the diffusion of technology, does limit the diffusion of drugs in a way we don't, which we didn't talk about, and they do, you know, what's sometimes called rationing. It's not, you probably wouldn't as an economist call it rationing, but it is a form of limiting of services that is something we'll have to have a discussion about in this country at some point.
Okay, I'll wrap these last two into one because they both go to the area of personal responsibility, what we as consumers of healthcare should be doing. If the panelists could comment on the role of personal responsibility, lifestyle, choices in healthcare and cost, for example, the issues of obesity, smoking, lack of exercise, where is our role in that? Also, what steps specifically can we in the audience, in our various roles, take to help bring about necessary changes?
I'll just pass this down and we can all comment for our closing here. And so just very briefly, and I think you probably have seen the data, I think the data on health status where it is personally in your control is it does contribute to healthcare spending. We are have a more significant obesity problem in this country, though others are unfortunately catching up. It is a contributor. It is, as Catherine said on the other points, not going to solve this problem. So it's sort of a piece, you know, that it is something people should address. It is a part. Everyone's got to be part of the solution, but by itself, it's not going to make the difference on healthcare spending. On what people should do, I do hope people take what Kevin said earlier forward. Talk to our congressional delegation. I personally believe Ellen's doing great work, but you heard she's making a drop in the bucket, and it's a very critical need to have a safety net when we have no universal coverage. This has to be a federal change. This has to happen at the national level, even though there's lots of rhetoric at the state level. States are trying this. Massachusetts is great, but unique. Every other state has failed. And to really get this passed, has to be national. Talk to our congressional delegation. Talk to other influential lobbyists. It is part of the economy. They've got it. There is more consensus that we need change than there was in 93-94, and it's got to happen.
I was just going to say briefly that to extend that, obviously voting is important. And six months ago, all the candidates said, well, we have to talk about health care reform. We have to put a proposal out last fall. And all the Democrats did, and the Republicans didn't. And the recent polls are saying, you know, people are kind of moving away from health again. It's, you know, it's really jobs, and the subprime market, and mortgage, and losing housing, and it's jobs, it's the economy, stupid, it's not healthcare anymore. So I think a lot of what all of us can do is to make sure that our elected representatives and those who hope to become our elected representatives know that healthcare is still very important. And then the second thing is you can remove a lot of ignorance too. You know, get on my team, cure ignorance. Talk to your spouses, talk to your kids, talk to your relatives, talk to your parents. There are all kinds of things we can all do to be responsible. Take the generic. When your doctor says, you know, well, why don't we knew this new? No, the old one's working okay with me. And, you know, there are a lot of things that we could do, and you can also cure ignorance.
Thank you. You'll hear me in double time. Ditto, ditto, ditto. As Marianne said, there are a lot of folks working at the local level doing a lot of really creative things, but it is literally a finger in the dike, and it is not the answer. And until we have a national solution, we're going nowhere fast. So vote, call your legislators, think globally, act locally, and I'll turn it over to you.
Well, on the personal responsibility stuff, I don't get it, quite honestly. I happen to care about whether or not I live or die. So I think each of us actually has a pretty strong vested interest in our health. And I continue, I'm sort of befuddled by the connection of health coverage to individual responsibility. We do know, quite honestly, if we increase copays, people get less services. Yeah? But we actually don't know whether that's a good or a bad thing, which is really interesting in terms of the whole thing. But I think, actually, the problem here is that when we talk about lifestyle, when we talk about responsibility, we're talking about a public health issue. And the way we have totally eviscerated our public health systems is coming back to haunt us. And so we're sort of putting the debate over in an area where it's really not appropriate. And it doesn't fit, and it's going to lead to solutions that actually may give us some sort of ideological peace, but the peace is not going to last very long. So we really need to get public health cranking again and to do with obesity what we did with smoking. I mean, it's pretty straightforward. Great.